you're the closest one to us, and so we're coming to you. Yeah.
We'll so, celebrate our anniversary that day.
Yeah, it was May 4th. Yeah, it was May 4th. It was our 19th wedding anniversary. So it was a great wedding gift.
Yeah.
But yeah, the Michelin fans are very active and very vocal. So my suggestion to people would be, you know, develop an online media following. And you don't have to be crazy. Just post what you're doing, what you have, what specials you're doing. And also do a little homework and find out who the reporters are in your neighborhood, like the beat reporters, who does the Bronx beat to the New York Times. Well, now it's the Metro. Who's the food blogger that covers your food? Or even look at competitors, people that you want to emulate, and see who's written them up. Like, I know one of the New York Times articles from Florence Fabricant, she had written up a restaurant a block away from us. And I was like, oh, wait, you know, we're here too. So write us up and don't be shy. You know, the worst thing they're going to say is no, you know?
That's great advice. Thank you. And then on a different note, I guess, so over the past year, it's obviously been a really difficult time for small businesses with the pandemic and everything that has gone on, especially in New York and other big cities. How were you and your business able to kind of pivot and survive the pandemic? And what were those challenges like, and how were you able to overcome?
Okay, you guys are gonna get tired of hearing me. So just so you guys know, I'm the business side and the marketing and everything else, and Claudia is the culinary side. So that's been the business division. But it wasn't a hard pivot for us, because we, in our business plan, we knew that we would be mostly takeout. So whereas other places like Le Bernardin, you know, high-end dining, no takeout, had to pivot, for us, it wasn't a problem. And when we opened on June 12th of 2020, they had just allowed the city to allow for takeout. And people, at least in our neighborhood where we have the restaurant, were kind of sick of the delis and the fast food chains and the pizza. And we're really different. We're the only Peruvian restaurant for 9 miles. The closest would be in Manhattan or going up towards Westchester. So there's nothing around. And then, you know, add to the fact that the food's really good. So it really helped, you know. So we
posted on Facebook. There's a Facebook page called Riverdale. And what we did, we posted that we're gonna open the restaurant that day. And it was very scary for us, because there was 2-3 restaurants that shut down in the block. And we didn't know. So, but we just rest. And I said, we need to open. We had the lease for 9 months, and we need to start making money. So, and it was very nice that weekend. It was a line outside. People was excited. They want to try the first Peruvian restaurant in the neighborhood. So it was nice. It was scary, but
people responded
so well.
Yeah, that week that we closed, 2 restaurants actually closed. The Subway franchise down the block from us, and a pizzeria that had been open for a year, but they really depended on Manhattan College. And there were no students. So it was scary, but like Claudia said, we had already put in everything into the restaurant, so it was either sink or swim, you know? So we decided to fight for it.
We sold out everything. It was nice.
That's great. And I guess, how do you feel like you've been able to set your restaurant apart over the past 13 years? In terms of getting, you know, the recognition you have gotten from Michelin Gourmand and other sources?
I mean, that's really Claudia, you know, it just goes to the food. I don't know if you've had the opportunity when we've done demos over there at Start Small, but the food is really that good. And, you know, it's a bit of alchemy. Like the flan, it's just 4 ingredients. It's milk, egg, sugar, and whatever the base flavor is, vanilla, chocolate, coffee. But the way she mixes it just makes a difference, you know?
A lot of people, they don't like the flan because we had to use eggs for the plant, and a lot of people say that when they eat, they can feel the tasting of the egg. And the way that I made it, I make the flan, you're not gonna taste the egg. So that's what makes that big difference.
Right. So I guess it's knowing your product and knowing your clients, and you know, our clients, it's broad, but you know, people who like good food, who like quality food, you know. And we try to be fair. In Spanish, we call it bueno, bonito y barato, which means good, aesthetically pleasing, and a good value. You know, that's the philosophy that we've used for restaurants that we go to, that we like, and we knew that that's what we wanted to give at our restaurant. You know, so I think really it's just the freshness. You know, people always comment how fresh, how healthy everything is, you know. Our empanadas, we make our dough in-house and they're baked. They're not deep fried. We offer salads, two different salads. We offer roasted vegetables. Our chicken is free range, hormone antibiotic free and baked. So it's showing people that healthy doesn't have to mean that it's not tasty. You know, it's the opposite. It could be just as or even more delicious than fried food. That's basically it. You know, just offering the best food that we can. And Claudia is a wizard in the kitchen also.
Well, it sounds like the food speaks for itself then. That's amazing. I have to share, I lived in Peru for a year up until the pandemic. And so I'm really craving some good Peruvian food as soon as I'm back in New York. I definitely wanna.
What part of Peru you will live in?
I was living an hour outside of Huancayo.
Up in the mountains.
I was in Huancayo a long time ago when I was single. It's very high, the altitude.
It is.
I remember going over there getting sick. Uh-huh. It's a beautiful. Uh-huh.
It's beautiful, yeah. Yeah, yeah, very
and cold.
High. And cold.
Very cold.
Yeah. I was bundled up most of the time, but that's great. In terms of the menu, how do you decide? Because I know you have your empanadas and you have your flan, but I know you also have like a rotating menu of dishes. Right. How do you decide what are the best dishes to put on the menu? Is it based on like?
Can you guys see the empanada?
Oh yeah.
And the chicken, mm-hmm. and then the flan. So those are three main things. But let Claudia answer.
When we decide about the menu, it will just start with a little appetizer, the empanada, and then the whole chicken could be with a side of rice, french fries, and then for dessert, we got the flan. But we add few more things because a lot of Peruvian people, they were asking for ceviche, lomo saltado, those are traditional dishes. So we start adding more and more items, and I know how to cook all the recipes, and I say, why not? So that's what...
But we planned this beforehand.
But people were asking for more veggie saltado, it wasn't in the menu, but we want to offer some healthy dish too.
Uh-huh. Right, so yeah, it's an evolution, but when we first started, we planned out the menu, so we knew we had those three main things that we provide. But from that, knowing that we were takeout, we wanted it to make it like easy for commuters because we're at 242nd Street. Yeah. It's a transit hub for going into Westchester and people that live in the area. So for commuters coming home, you could just pick up a chicken, or if you want to add some sides, you have the salad. We have a combo where you can get the chicken salad and your choice of two sides, all Peruvian dishes. Or just get the chicken and you dress it up at home, you know, with whatever you want. Right. So then it became an evolution of let's not waste, right? So the chicken, it can become soup, can become empanadas, can become toppings for the salad, can become other dishes like ají de gallina. So trying not to waste anything, right?
Yeah, so trust me, we don't waste anything here. There's a lot of people they're working with us, and I say, wow, you're pretty good trying to use everything, even the vegetable we just put on the broth with the chicken, and it tastes very good. People love the chicken soup. And then, yeah, we use.
Right. Our chicken soup is almost like a bone broth because mm-hmm. she boils down the bones.
4 hours.
Yeah. So it becomes really rich and healthy. So it's you know, looking, and also at the start of when we opened, remember things were scarce, right? It wasn't just supermarkets, but the wholesalers, things were scarce and hard to come by. So we wanted to have, we had to provide stuff that was available, and also trying to keep within our theme of not wasting stuff, or not wasting food items. And yeah, Claudia's been very successful at that.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Thank you. I'm so hungry. What would you say has been the biggest turning point in your business, and how did you handle it? Was it like moving into a retail or restaurant space, or what would you say
was the biggest turning point? Yeah, you know, that was a hard question because, I mean, there's a lot of different turning points, right? Like, one was when Claudia decided to start doing the business. Another was when we decided to pivot from wholesaling to retailing. I don't know. It's not like an easy answer. You know, there's not just like